Well, hello, everybody. Welcome to Travel Talk Tuesday tonight. It is March the 8th, 2022. And here we go, a brand new month. Last week was March 1st, I guess. So the second series in this month. We've been going on for, I think we're approaching about 65 episodes that we've been going on since December of 2020. So thank you guys for joining me tonight. I've spent the last three weekends in various cities in the United States visiting travel shows. And as I mentioned last week, we were in Chicago a couple of weekends ago. We were in Washington, D.C. 2 weekends ago. And then I was in Boston this past weekend and met a lot of great people in all of the destinations. I can tell you, people are itching to get back to travel because we've been going our own 2 years now, being on COVID-19, wondering what it is, going through mask mandates, trying to get out of it, vaccines and everything else. And I can tell you that we were over the weekend, just this past Saturday. I'm not sure if it was the city of Boston or all of Massachusetts, just totally ditched the mask mandate totally. And you know, me living in Florida, we've not had that very, very much here in this state. So I would say since the summer of 2020 or the fall of 2020, we've not had any 100% mask mandate. So being up there in Boston this weekend, there were people visiting me at the booth that didn't know what to do. They were asking, can I take my mask off? And I said, well, look at me. I don't have one on, so I'm all okay. So the world's opening up. We're going to be in New York City in 2 weeks. And I understand that just today or yesterday that New York State and New York City just ditched the entire mask mandate as well. So things are looking up for travel. And I guess we're getting a handle on COVID. Looks like cases are going down worldwide and the chance of contracting it are getting more and more slim. So I've got a threefold message tonight on Travel Talk Tuesday. I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about the war in Ukraine and Russia's infringement upon their borders. I wanna talk to you a little bit about the COVID-19 mandates and how things are going around of Europe especially. And then the brunt of tonight's talk is on Poland and Zakopane, Poland, which is a little resort area in the border area between Slovakia and Poland. So let me go ahead and run these maps. I'm gonna unshare my screen and we'll kind of look at this and I'll talk you through the process here. Okay, so this morning I just kind of sketched out a map of Europe, and we've seen these on all of the news channels. But since tonight I'm talking about Poland, and Poland is really in the news along with Russia and Ukraine, I wanted to kind of give you a geography lesson about where this information and this story tonight is originating and how closely it is related to what's going on in the Ukraine. So we're talking about this area in Poland in green, and their flag is a red and white flag. And Kraków is the destination that I talked about a couple of weeks ago. And just below Kraków is the village of Zakopane, which is right in the mountains that separate Slovakia from Poland. Now, we've all seen this information in the news and these cities and everything about Kyiv and about Lviv. And you know that people are migrating and immigrating and escaping the Russian invasion throughout Ukraine and heading to the West. And they go to this little city here. And from there, they try to get over into Poland. And it's my understanding that 1.2 million have already immigrated or at least made it to Poland as refugees. And so Poland and this region around Krakow, Zakopane, and everywhere in between that is probably heavily inundated with refugees who were escaping there. As I was sitting here this morning trying to think about all of this, just a few years ago, I recall being in the train station in Milan, Italy. And this was during the time that Syria was being invaded and refugees were leaving Syria, heading north through Turkey, coming through Greece and Eastern European countries, making their way through Austria, Germany, and to other parts of the European Union, the cities in Europe. And I encountered a whole group of Syrians that were right there in the train station in Milan. And there was a humanitarian organization who had set up camps and beds and cots for them in that huge fascist train station that Mussolini constructed, and they were taking care of those refugees. And that's what my mind's eye goes back to now, thinking about these refugees coming from Ukraine into Poland and to other parts of Europe as well. So again, as I said last week, the news only gets worse. Every day we listen to it. And if we are totally concentrated on that, we may think that what on the earth is the world coming to? But all we can do is send out our prayers to those folks that are refugees, our prayers for those leaders that are for Mr. Putin and Zelensky and everyone else that is concerned, and hope and pray that things will be solved and will come to an end. But until that time, life goes on for the rest of us in this world. And, we hear here in the United States is affecting us heavily, but we're an ocean away. So our gas prices are going up. I think I paid $8.99 for chicken breast the other night, which is crazy. Gas prices, I got at Costco yesterday for $3.75, and that was a bargain. But just down the road here in Florida, it's $4.17 for a gallon of regular gas. But, it's bad for us, but it's a small price to pay, because just think of what those folks in Ukraine, they have no homes, no nothing left, and they're refugees now. So again, thoughts and prayers go out all to them. I just wanted to show you that. Let me run this fast forward a little bit more. And I want to go, because this question came up quite a bit over the weekend. Now, many people, I get these two terms confused: Baltic countries and Balkan countries. And the Baltic states, or the Baltic countries, are those three countries of Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania. Those three countries, as you can see, are bordering on Russia or Belarus, who is leaning toward the Russian lifestyle and ethics and political persuasion. But they are part of the United Nations. There is, let me check my notes here, 6.2 million people there in the Baltic states. I was privileged to have an exhibition booth right next to a friend who lives in Lithuania that is selling tours to the Baltic states. Unfortunately, he didn't have a whole lot of traffic, but he had a whole lot of conversation, because people were just trying to learn the geography of the whole area. But I had a lot of people come up to me and say, you've got tours in the Balkan and the Croatia and all of that. And I'm sure that's not selling very well. And I had to tell them, the Balkans and the Baltics are totally different, just because they start with a B. But the Balkan states are those that border the Adriatic Sea all the way over to the Black Sea down there, that were part of the former country known as Yugoslavia. And so they consist of, I'll probably miss some of them, but they consist of, let me point as I look. They consist of Slovenia, Croatia, Montenegro, North Macedonia, Albania, Bosnia, Herzegovina. I think I've got that wrong. And then I can't remember this one right here, but we'll have to look at that one up. But that's, I think that's part of the Balkans as well, former Yugoslavia. And then right below that is Greece, of course. So anyway, just a little geography lesson, history lesson, and we'll move on from that. By the way, I mentioned that those states, the Baltic states, are part of the European, or part of the European Union, and more importantly, part of NATO. You see that Poland's part of NATO, Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia is as well. Here's the big controversy in this war that's going on, where Russia is invading, in that this entire country here that's under attack, the Ukraine, is being inundated by the Russians that are here. And this is Belarus right on top of that. So just so you know about the EU nations, or that NATO nations as well. Okay, let me let this run. Here's some great news. This came across my newsfeed and email this morning. And we knew this happened over the weekend because I was right across the aisle from Aer Lingus, the Irish Airlines, who were are promoting tours, and sometimes we fly with them and over to Ireland as well. But Ireland has totally nixed anything to do with COVID-19 mask mandates, testing, or anything else. So it says visitors no longer need to complete and or provide the following. They don't have to complete a passenger locator form. They don't have to have evidence of being fully vaccinated. They do not have to provide evidence of being recovered. And they don't have to provide evidence of a not detected or negative COVID-19 PCR test or antigen test. And that's happening all over Europe. So I know that Slovenia has done the same thing. And that's really the kind of the rule that all of the EU nations are going to be working toward in the next 6 weeks, I think. So by the time I give this presentation on Travel Talk Tuesday, maybe in the middle of April, I can say that, you know, all of the EU countries are following the same guidelines, and you can travel there freely without having tests, without being vaccinated and or anything. So that's some really good news for us. Now, on to Poland. Let me talk about food in Poland. Now, I'm just going to let this slide run and talk to you because Cheryl and I were 5 days in Poland, and you can see that this is soup with some bread, and there's soup all over the place, very hearty soups, plus every piece of meat that we got had gravy on it. And Charlotte's right there with a potato pancake, which is right up her alley, a nice fresh salad. And so we got potatoes all on there. We got potatoes, a lot of salad. That's a chicken and salad there. This is dessert, and it was some kind of chocolate cake. So, and with that raspberry sauce, very nice. In Poland, they use their own currency. And this was a little English translation of the menu that we saw. This was in Zakopane. This is one of the restaurants we went to, and local wine that we had from the area. And some of the bread and appetizers that we had with oil. I even got escargot there, believe it or not, at this wonderful restaurant we visited the first night. But here we go again with soup. It's mostly pureed vegetable or soup with types of bacon in it. These steaks were just fantastic, but you can see lots of bread, lots of potatoes. There's my T-bone steak. That was one of the best meals that we've had in a long, long time. Even last week, and I was up in Boston and had a ribeye steak that didn't compare to this. I just had to show you what it looks like. So that was really good. You can tell it's really good because I took a lot of photos of it, right? And this was that local wine we had, and I can't pronounce any of the names there in Poland. And if we saw in the Cyrillic alphabet, you would have no chance. Here's another meal we had with another soup. It always had this parsley stuff and spices sprinkled on the top. Salad abounded as well. We got a salad at every meal that we had. This was sort of like a chicken pot pie that was inside a crust. This was the guy next to us that had a hamburger. This restaurant was way up on the hilltop in Zakopane. There's Cheryl and I enjoying our lunch. Another image of the 211 Krona, I think is the name of it. It was about $50 for our lunch. Now, this is kind of interesting. My bus driver friend from the Netherlands, Peter or Peter, he would always said, everywhere we traveled all over Europe, he always says he can speak Czech. And so all you have to do when you speak Czech is put ski on the end of it. And so I came across this box that was in a grocery store, and I bought them, cracker ski. And so I sent him this image saying, now I know how to speak, not Czech, now I need to know how to speak Polish, because here we are drinking or eating cracker ski. This is a village of Zakopane. They have beer there. This is a homebrew beer there. And this was a very hearty piece of beef with crusted potatoes on top of it that Charlotte got one night. I had the sausages and everything. You can imagine a lot of that too. But you see, potatoes are worth everything. Here we are. If you've seen, been watching me the last few weeks, this is us leaving Krakow and driving into the mountains, the Tatras Mountains, in the southern part of Poland. You see that house style, which has two gabled roofs going both directions like a plus sign?
Hey, David McGuffin here. Welcome to Travel Talk Tuesday. I am in a winter wonderland. I'm in the town of Zakopane, Poland. It's a ski resort here in the mountains, right on the border of Slovakia. And it's just a beautiful place. We've arrived here today, this afternoon. The snow just started. And like I say, a virtual winter wonderland. Back in the Soviet times, this was one of the only destinations those who lived in Poland could come to have a vacation, either in summer to hike the mountains or in the winter to come up to ski. Now it's known Europe-wide, and it's very well founded and very well discovered. But we arrived here just a few days before Christmas, and a lot of families are here, but not so many people. So I hope you enjoy this look around Zakopane, right here in Poland.
This was our apartment hotel. And we could have moved in here and stayed a week or two or three. We had a living room, bedroom, kitchen. And I want to talk about the architectural style. I mentioned to you, if you look down from the sky, they all look like plus signs because they have these huge roofs, very steeply pitched, and they originate from an architectural style called Zakopane architectural style from the late 1800s. For us Floridians, seeing a little snow just made it even that much better. And so I got out early the second morning that we were there, and took some photos. This is the main street, and you can see a very big difference between the traditional housing and this like one square block of modern downtown. And I imagine that some large company has moved in, built those buildings, and they put in sort of a mall right there. But that's it. The rest of it is this quaint little town that in the summer, it's a destination to go before you hike in all the Tatras Mountains. In the winter, a destination to go.
This is the walk up the street to our B&B. Our Turtle Mountain Chalet, we kind of rented an apartment here for two nights. Just happened across this town last night when we were eating in a restaurant in Krakow, and our young waitress said, well, you should go to Zakopane. It's in the mountains, a beautiful resort. So we got in the car this morning and drove down here. We're really gonna like it. I just think it's a delightful little town. As you can see, so many kids and families, place to go for vacation. Our mountain chalet is right here.
Gewohnt. And the W is pronounced as a V, like it is in German. And
we're going to hunker down for a couple of days and relax before we have to make the drive back to Munich. Mm. Hey, this is our apartment.
Get up, Charlotte. Let's show our apartment.
Wonderful little area, sitting area, living room, full kitchen here.
I think she was playing Wordle.
Our bedroom. What the pillow says, everything is going to be all right. Bathroom. So very nice. Very nice look around. Charlotte, how you like this place?
I like it a lot. It's very nice. It's beautiful.
Let's see what it is. Little patio out here.
That type of decor is typical throughout Alpine regions in Germany and Austria, and obviously Poland as well.
So we've decided to hang out here for a couple of days and just chill out before we have to make the long trek back to Munich and back to the United States.
It is only 5:30 and it's been dark since 4 o'clock, but the snow is abounding. And we're going in search for somewhere to have dinner. Not tonight, this late afternoon. I think we're going for the Old Farts Early Bird special is what we're trying to go for. They don't really have it here, but at home we would never go to dinner at 5:30. What do you think, Charlotte?
I think it's beautiful here.
Yeah.
It's another winter wonderland.
Yeah. Okay, we'll catch you in a little bit and see what's going on. So we had that dinner, that steak dinner was this first night. It was, I look up things on TripAdvisor anywhere I go and try to go for highly rated places. And this was the most highly rated
place. The destination is on your left. Plak Niepodległość 7.
You can see Siri speaks a little Polish as well. But it is well worth
arrived.
And at that time, you know, a meal I would pay $200 for in the United States cost us about $75, I think, there in Poland.
Hey, so we just had dinner right down here past these blinking Christmas trees. The snow has been falling for the last hour and a half or so, and everything is covered in fresh powdered snow. We're having a great time here in Poland. What's the name of this town, Charlotte?
Wait a minute. Zakopane.
Zakopane.
I can only imagine what this looks like in the summer because I've looked up on the internet photos and everything. And it's, you know, green,
hey,
lush mountains in the background.
What do you think about this snow?
I love it.
Floridians love snow.
It's coming down like crazy. For us Floridians, it's way out of character.
This is back to the town square where that Christmas tree was and little bridge. Now it's probably about 8 o'clock at night, which feels like about midnight for us. Thank you.
I guess we've reached the town square here, and there's a celebration going on with fire eaters and flamethrowers and everything else at the Christmas market. Pretty cool.
This is the next morning, but before I do that, you see I'm looking in the oven here. We're having a Polish meal for sure. We're having roasted potatoes, which showed up at every meal that we had in Poland. We also are having, we call it kielbasa here, but that was not a word that was used, sausage. And you saw that in a couple of the food videos that I showed you earlier. But so sausage, kielbasa, and asparagus. We're drinking the wine tonight. Is not any Polish wine, but I did show you two that I couldn't pronounce, but that we're drinking another variety of that decoy wine that I shared last week. This is their Cabernet Sauvignon, and it's a product of California, really good. Again, bought it at Winn-Dixie. It's on sale for about $18 a bottle, and really nice and full. This is the next morning after that dinner we had. And so we're walking around the town center and park. You can see the snow has ceased, but there's plenty of it on the ground. This is the historic city center. Notice those roof lines and double gabled homes and buildings. Lots of wood. This is the main street. Rossmann's is a drugstore chain throughout Europe. Looks like they have more than drugs there, like souvenirs and everything else. But we're walking toward, if you see the mountain in the background, we're going to take a funicular cog railway up to the top of that.
I saw these characters in several videos.
Why do we have to have these crazy things all over the place? And here's Charlotte looking at some of the crafts that are on display, and she's not really too impressed with them, I don't think. There on the left-hand side was a whole building full of kiosks that sold those types of crafts, but every shop had pretty much the same thing. Probably if I looked on the backside of them, they would not have been made in Poland, maybe ROC. And, you know, that for me, I had to learn that when I was in Europe as well, because our products say made in China. In Europe, it says made in ROC, Republic of China, just to make it maybe sound a little bit better. I don't know. This was the Catholic church in town. Beautiful. And here we walked across the little river, and we're walking in the direction of the cog railway. And all of these shops were, we thought maybe were Christmas markets, but later we found out that they're there all of the time selling their wares. You'll hear Charlotte's comment about it a little bit later. But beautiful, beautiful countryside. I'm going to toss my roasted potatoes here in the oven real quick. Maybe.
Szanowni Państwo, dla wspólnego bezpieczeństwa prosimy o stosowanie się do wytycznych i zasad odpowiedzialnego podróżowania w góry. Na terenie ośrodków PKL prosimy o zakrycie ust i nosa, również w stacji kolei i w wagonie. Dezynfekcję dłoni po wejściu do poczekalni.
So you can see we got on this cog railway. I even had to have workers clean it off every now and then. And here we're heading up the hill to this town called, I gotta look at my notes, Gubawova. And we made it to the top, got off the railway, a couple of photo shots with these, which we later found out was the Hill of Lights. And so there's Charlotte and I. Here's how you pronounce it. That L with a little cross over it is pronounced with a W sound. It looks like in my editing, I forgot to close the blackened gaps. So just bear with me and we'll talk a little bit about it. But this was a wonderful place because when you got to the top, there was tons of people up there and you didn't even realize it, but you can see Zakopane down in the valley here. Well, I imagine we were about 2,000 feet above Zakopane. Hey, David McGuffin here, high above the town of Zakopane down there in the basin below. And we've taken a funicular up to the area called Gubavolka. I think that's right, Gubavolka. And it's a ski slope, but funicular and everything comes up here. So it's a beautiful day, nice sunshiny day.
I think I was using the wrong term. It's a cog railway. A funicular is one of those that's on a cable that goes up, I do believe.
So this is the Tatras mountain range that kind of defines the border between Poland, which is here, looking a little bit to the southeast, or actually to the southwest, to Slovakia. The town down below. I don't know why there is a need to make snow. But I'm not a skier, so I don't really know. Maybe they're just pumping some into some areas where it's needed. And then we have this whole resort up here area, which we're gonna kind of walk around and check out.
That's my idea of sledding, a little baby slope.
Knowing me, I probably would have run into the fence.
How's the song go? Dashing through the snow in a one horse open sleigh over the fields.
You probably saw this a few weeks ago, maybe, but I've got to show it again. Our only sleigh ride in our life.
Making spirits bright. What fun it is to ride and sing a sleighing song tonight. Oh, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride on a one-horse open
Notice
sleigh.
I have no harmony.
Jingle bells, jingle bells,
I don't know
bells,
why she won't sing along.
All the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Hey, Merry Christmas from David and Charlotte McGuffin. Your adventure starts right here with David McGuffin's Exploring Europe, where you've got a real sleigh ride going on here. Never done that before. We've had a buggy ride with wheels on it, but this is a real live sleigh ride with a horse and an authentic driver.
You can tell what the horse is about to do. I can't wait. So we've taken this funicular up above the village of Zakopane. There's a stay there two nights. And it's got wonderful views of all of the mountains and everything around here. But evidently the specialty is this goat cheese. And we've seen vendors after vendors after vendors in town and everywhere else selling that. And a lot of them take it and fry it on a hibachi or a grill or a wok or something. And serve it. So I got a salad with it. And so this is it. So this is the fried goat cheese, but I also got soup that had the goat cheese in the soup along with potatoes and ham. And the salad has ham in it as well. So I guess it's a regional specialty. It sat here for probably 20, 30 minutes. It's not warm any longer, but it is really good. So anyway, this is what we've done this afternoon here up in the village above Zakopane in the mountains, the Tatras Mountains.
I see the Seri cheese is how it's
so we were just checking our facts here. And everything I said was correct, except it was not goat milk cheese. Except it wasn't goat's cheese. In the menu here and all over this region, it is called sheep's milk cheese. At least that's the English translation. And so it was very good. Sheep's milk cheese. I don't know. I think we know that as pecorino in Italy. And we see all these sheep all over the place in Ireland and Scotland and the UK and all of this. And so there's plenty of sheep. And actually, Charlotte saw a little sheep that was smaller than a dog up here today. But we've not seen all the sheep to make this cheese here. But it was pretty amazing. So sheep milk cheese. That's it. Over and out.
Charlotte got a kick out of the word for toilet. Just a few more looks from up on the top of the hill. There was a lot of vendors up there. You could take away food just like at Christmas markets that had the mulled red and white wine and any other thing you wanted, hot chocolate or whatever else, coffee, beer. So I called these people on video. This guy had just proposed. He just had kneeled down and stood up, putting the ring on her hand. And there they are kissing. We later connected with them and I gave them all the videos, airdropped them all to them. So he didn't want them, but his fiance certainly did.
So it says...
Wait a minute. So down below, we were thinking it said something like Merry Christmas or whatever, but actually the English translation is the Land of Light. How is it pronounced, Charlotte? But it is beautiful, right? The Land of Light.
Yeah. Yes, it is very beautiful.
I'm going to flip the phone around so you can see some more up here so we can just talk.
So, what are we going to talk about?
Well, we're going to talk about this place right here where we bought a couple of glasses of hot mull wine. And then up here above, there is a road that runs on the ridge for 3 or 4 miles. And that's where we took our sleigh ride.
Yes. Which was amazing.
Yeah, but then...
All with the jingle bells.
Yeah. Although Charlotte doesn't know the words.
Charlotte doesn't know the words to
jingle bells or anything.
I didn't want to sing because there were too many people watching.
But here's the view from that road and from where we're standing right now. What time is it?
It is...
Sunset.
56.
Yeah, sunset was 3:48. It's crazy. I didn't realize we were that far north, but still, we're looking down on the village. Where we?
The village?
Yeah, the village. Yeah. Where
village?
We came up from. What is it called?
Zakopane.
And down there, where those yellow lights are, is kind of where our hotel is. And then we took the funicular up all the way up here. We've been here for the last 3 or 4 hours. We had a great time. And this is a place for families to come to because
We have seen so many little kids, babies, and prams on sleds all over the place. And I think it's the place that the Polish bring all their kids to spend a few days before Christmas time. Everywhere we've gone, there have been kids.
On our way back down the hill on the Cog Railway, not the funiculare. You can hear all the kids. So Charlotte and I are lamenting. It's only 4:15. Totally dark here. Sunset was 30 minutes ago. We've taken the lift down to Zakopane. This is all the markets are here. And Charlotte, what do you say this stuff is?
Crap.
Yeah, so it's not really worth purchasing anything here. Nothing handmade. So now we're walking back toward our hotel neighborhood. Maybe we're going to take a little rest and get up and go to dinner. We understand there's some traditional music and things in the restaurants at 7:30 or so. So maybe we'll try that. Anyway, we'll catch you later on tonight from Zakopane.
A lot of people here too, you know?
I don't know how I managed to end up here. So at our hotel, I asked for a place with some music. I was thinking of a string quartet or something, traditional Polish music. Obviously, we had two different things in mind, so they sent us to this place. It is kind of nice. Two guitar players with loops and sound machines and whatnot. A lot of people seem to like it. But who knows? I got a lager beer, a huge one. And I guess we're gonna get some food. We'll see what it all works out with. Hey, David McGuffin here. We're ready to head out of Zakopane and Poland today, but I hope you've enjoyed this look around this beautiful, delightful little town right here in southern Poland. There's a lot to be said for Poland. We spent 5 nights here in the big city of Krakow. We stayed out at Auschwitz, and we also stayed here in Zakopane. So, until next time, your adventure starts right here with David McGuffin's Exploring Europe. Okay, so that kind of concludes what we're doing tonight. You heard me mention the name Auschwitz, and we had that was our first experience in Poland. And of course, we all recognize that term as being part of a German concentration camp back in during World War II, the later days of World War II. And it was a hugely educational, but yet sobering experience as well. And given the fact that we're right in the midst of this oppression of the Russians over the Ukrainians, I'm going to go ahead and change up my schedule for next week and give you my take on the concentration camp, or the several concentration camps there in Auschwitz. And we hope and pray that things will look a lot better for the Ukrainians after 7 more days, and that they receive some humanitarian and military aid and everything else. So I'll leave it with that. We'll be praying for for those people and for all the leaders in the world to make the right decisions. So thanks for watching Travel Talk Tuesday tonight. We'll catch you next week. See you later. Bye-bye.